No. Hello, hello. I'm just going to wait for a few more people to join. So we're a little bit early.
Paula, will this be available online after?
Yes, yeah. Everything is going to be recorded and we'll share it, and I will share the links and even the videos with you so you can share them around. We've already had some hearts and likes. Okay. Bless you.
Sorry, that's the phone going.
Okay, so just a reminder, when anybody in particular is talking, if you can mute yourself, that would be good. But to start with, we'll all be fairly open. So good evening. We've got some people coming in now. So thank you very much for joining us. This is the third event that we've had today for World Bee Day. And so I'm joined by a wonderful selection of honey experts. And we're going to be doing a live honey tasting of Ilanga-Nature honeys. I've got some behind me here. And we've all got some that we can sample and discuss. So those of you who are watching at home, if you want to comment, you just comment in the feed and we will see your comments, but we won't be answering questions as we go. We'll wait until the end. So we'll go through the whole tasting session, and then at the end we can do some questions and answers. So do type them in because we will see them and we will look at them later on. Okay, so the plan tonight is that we're going to each taste some honeys, and some of us are going to taste the same honeys, and we're going to discuss what we think of the honeys, the particular flavors, and we're also going to be educated about various traits of honeys. Some are natural, some are desirable, some are not so desirable. So it'll help those of you who are not that aware of honey about how to choose and select your honey, knowing that you're getting the best quality you can. And the goal of this is that we're raising awareness about Ilanga-Nature honey, which is from Madagascar, but also the fact that the beekeepers there need to feed their bees and they need more trees to feed their bees. So we've set up a crowdfunder and we're hoping to raise enough that we can plant 1 million trees. So we're leaving the crowdfunder open till the 19th of June. And all these events can be shared and viewed up until that time. So I hope that you will share. And what we are doing is we're having a competition so that whoever tags and shares the most out of all the viewings, all the events that we've done, they will actually win one of these beautiful wooden boxes with a selection of 5 Ilanga-Nature honeys. So we'll announce that on the 19th of June. So first of all, I'd like to go round and we're just going to introduce the guests. So each guest will just have just a brief introduction so that you have an idea of who everybody is. So I'm going to start with Amina, and Amina's come all the way from California tonight.
Well, I haven't gone very far, but I run the Honey and Pollination Center at UC Davis. And I've been involved in the varietal honey industry for over 40 years. So I'm very excited to be here today.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. So now we'll go around to Steve.
I'm Steve Rogenstein. I'm the founder of the Ambeessadors. And we are a consultancy and collective with a dual mission of connecting the bee community and spreading awareness of and appreciation for the importance of bees and pollinators. And we do that through events and research, education, partnerships, advocacy, art, and more.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. And I've got my Ambeessador Okay, and Madvee.
Hi there, I'm Madvee Muthu. I'm the founder of a brand called Bees with Stories. The whole mission of the company and the brand is to help African beekeepers sell their bee products, starting with honey and beeswax. And the idea is to help them make a better living out of beekeeping and also help on forest conservation work.
Wonderful. And Laura.
Hello, hi. I do sales and marketing for Heather Hills Farm. We're a Scottish artisan honey producer based in Perthshire. And we just celebrated our 75th birthday last week on VE Day. So we are one of the most leading and established producers here. We have 1,300 hives and we produce our own Scottish blossom and heather honeys. Everything is extracted using traditional artisan methods, and our bees and hives are well spaced out in the most beautiful, unpolluted places of Scotland. Majority are in the Cairngorms National Park. So our bees have plenty of room to forage to gather the finest nectar. We never force feed our bees sugar, and we always ensure our honeys are raw, so they're never heated over the normal temperature of the hive, because that, as you know, caramelizes the flavor of the honey and destroys the flavor, but it also destroys the natural goodness of the honey as well. So I'm really, really excited to be here. I should say we're really excited to be here, so thank you so much for inviting us. Because we just have this fascination about all the different plethoras of all the honey varietals around the world, and how each one is unique, dictated by the nectar of the flower and the region where the flower grows, to protect the flower and to attract the beneficial pollinators to it, and to deter the prey from it so it can sort of maintain its survival. So it's just really, really exciting to taste all these lovely flavors and experience all these different places that we've never really been before, particularly at this time of COVID where we can't really travel. So we can let our palate travel at the same time as well.
Oh, beautifully put. And I do love your display. It's just, I think you've got to win the prize for the best online background for a honey tasting session.
Thank you.
So some people may not be aware of exactly where Madagascar is. So I've got this map here. So it shows you the world, and you can see the red island at the bottom there, just off Africa. That is actually Madagascar. And here we've got a close-up of the island, and it's actually twice the size of the UK, so it is pretty vast. When I was a teenager, it was the place that had the most diverse and unexplored rainforest and forest in the world, and very, very sadly, it's been severely deforested, as Madvee will comment on later, I'm sure. And so it's very passionate, it's a cause for me that I'm really sad to see all this amazing biodiversity lost. And yet the beekeepers there are changing it all and managing to become the guardians of the forest. So those of you who watched any of the earlier sessions, you would have heard the interview with Laura, who runs the beekeepers over there, and where she's talking about how the beekeepers are now saving the trees. So there is a real connection between the trees and the bees. And as you'll learn this evening, that some of the honeys we're tasting are from those trees, and they're really, really special trees. So I'm just gonna show a short film which shows the beekeepers, and we'll give you a taste of, after looking at a place on a map, it's very different when you see it for real. So this is as close as we can all get to Madagascar at the moment.
Open up your eyes, there is nowhere left for us to hide. Get the feeling that we're lost, these hands are tied, and there are no disguises. Walking with the sand, we are nothing but strangers to this land. Can we keep it in our hearts?
There we go. I just love that music. And I've had so many comments today about, oh, we love the music and it's quite emotional. So I think Ilanga-Nature are going to have to do a CD now of their honey music. And you'd see from the video that there's actually a truck that travels around, and that truck is a honey extraction vehicle. So it visits these beekeepers in their very remote areas and takes the honey, extracts it, gives the beekeepers back the frames. So you're minimizing the risk of contamination or adulteration, which is a huge global issue with honey. So honey is often adulterated, it's watered down, mixed with other types of syrups or even other varieties of honey. So Ilanga are able to really know exactly what variety of honey they've just extracted and separated all. And the beekeepers, they're guaranteed an income, they're sold their honey, and the honey's bottled, packaged, everything in Madagascar, and then sent off to Europe. So you're all here to enjoy some honey tasting. So we're going to go to Amina, who's going to kick us off with our first honey. So I believe you've got the wildflower. Hang on.
And it comes from a specific area of Madagascar, which I believe is on the eastern side. It's what's called the humid forest, and there's actually a dry forest. So the country has lots of different ecologies and weather patterns. So what's interesting about this is that the honey itself is crystallized. So you can see that it's all pretty crystallized, pretty evenly crystallized. Wait, let me get it in front of the camera. Okay, so you can see that it's quite evenly crystallized. And when honey is crystallized, the scent is much harder to take through, you know, to get into your nose. And it's always a good idea first to warm it in some way, but I don't want to destroy these honeys by warming them too often. Even if I do it gently, it will affect the flavor if you keep repeating and doing it over and over. So, as I mentioned, this honey is crystallized. Almost all of the honeys that we've gotten from Madagascar are, and all honey will crystallize naturally. Sometimes we force the crystallization because we want the exact crystal to be smooth in a specific way, but not with this one. This is just the way it comes. You can get a peek into the inside. I've been digging at it because it's very delicious. So if you smell it, the smell is very light at this point. As I said, it is crystallized, so the smell is less intense. And it's a little bit candy-like. One of the things I've learned is that we use different words here in the U.S. than you tend to use in Europe and the U.K. for descriptions. We have different backgrounds, different historical backgrounds. So we tend to find different words to work with. When I started describing honeys for my business, Moonshine Trading Company, in the early 1980s, I couldn't find the words. I didn't know what to say. So it took a long time to understand that every honey really tastes very, very unique. And we have to figure out what those flavors are and to go way back into our mind to find them. Sometimes it's a memory and sometimes it's a hit that just goes, oh yes, I know what that tastes like. So with this honey, I'm going to do, because normally I stir a honey when it's crystallized, you can't. I mean, you can, but it's not going to do very much. And I take a little taste first. I let it dissolve in my mouth and I try to analyze what that is. And then I taste it again. I always do it two times because the first taste is often a reaction against what's just sitting in your mouth. And the second one tends to be a little bit purer. Now, while it's in my mouth, I'm paying attention to all the different flavors that are happening. I close my mouth, believe it or not, I do stop talking. And I close my mouth and I try to bring all the scent into my nose by blowing into my nose through my mouth. All the receptors for flavor are at the back of your mouth at the base of your nose. So they're not really flavors that you're tasting. There's only four flavors you can really taste, but you're getting a lot of aroma So on the second taste, what I get is a wonderful, and I did this last night and said, I can't believe what I'm getting. It's like a mixture of lemon drops and butterscotch together. There's an incredible citrusy flavor that goes underneath your tongue and sits there and just is, it's just delightful. It's like having a lemon drop is the best way I can describe it. It's an amazing flavor. So one of the things I also did was I tried to research what the flowers are that this honey is coming from. And I discovered that the native flowers of Madagascar simply aren't listed. The biodiversity of the floral sources is so high, even to today, it's still very high, that they just don't make a listing of what they are, and exactly where bees are going for this one is probably unknown. But from its flavor, it definitely has a little bit of some of the eucalyptus that'll be described a little bit later. So I think it's a really interesting blend. Now, when I talk about honey, also I use the UC Davis honey wheel that we designed at the university. And what I try to do is talk about the different things that you see around the outside edge. So you see fruity and floral, herbaceous, woody, spicy. I don't like to tell people what things taste like. Everybody tastes differently. We all have completely different taste receptors in the way we taste, the way we remember, the way we catalog everything. But in this case, this particular one would fall into the fruity character and probably under citrus. So if you look at fruity up here, we've got berry, citrus, dried fruit, tree fruit, and tropical fruit. And this one really has a very strong citrus and a hint of the tropics. So there's sort of like a little bit of guava and a little bit of mango in there. You get a lot of interesting fruit, but it's all hiding underneath my tongue. I don't taste it on top of my tongue. So I think we should move on and try a few others and then come back and talk about them more, unless you have some questions for me.
Okay, that was wonderful, Amina. What a great start and a real education about the complexity of honeys, you know, and what we can be looking for. And yeah, really, really wonderful. And some of us here have been studying under the Italian Register of Honey Sensory Analysis, and there to classify honeys, they try and find the same words to describe each honey. And it is really difficult. And on the last workshop that Madvee and Laura and I were on together, and I'd brought some of my honey, which I knew was lime tree. And it was really interesting because it was only from the whole group tasting it and with the Italian, the tutors who are phenomenal with their knowledge of honey, that I then realized that their way of distinguishing a lime tree honey is the bitter aftertaste, because they always have sweet chestnut flowering at the same time. Whereas where I am, we don't have the sweet chestnut. So you just get the lime. So that can be confusing. And, you know, when I talk about the jujube, it's interesting as well. This whole, every flower has a different response, you know, when it's depending what region it's come from. So thank you very much for that. So now, Steve, you're going to talk to us about eucalyptus.
I'm going to talk about eucalyptus, but I'm also going to talk about the medicinal properties of honey, or some of them. And I'm really glad that Amina started, because she gave a little overview of how you taste, which I think is really important. And when we do tastings, we talk about separating smell from taste, because you only have taste receptors for five different flavors. And it's the complement of smell that creates this flavor in your mouth. And before I actually talk about the eucalyptus, which for me is super interesting and is the reason why I chose to talk about this one, is because what you smell is not what you taste at all. And I think that that's a beautiful quality, because when we talk about what the scents and flavors are, it's amazing, this contrast, because some honeys smell exactly as they taste, but this is not the case with the eucalyptus. So I'd like to share my screen and talk about honey and medicinal properties of it, if that's okay.
Of course, brilliant.
So, there are many things about honey and bees that we all find fascinating. And we're going to talk about some of the properties of honey that are really interesting. Everybody knows about honey being a sweetener, but lesser known are its medicinal properties. Although, maybe you've been taking medicine all along and not even noticing it. So, for instance, when you have a sore throat, you always hear, oh, drink hot tea with honey. And when you do this, what I would recommend, as Laura said, is wait for the tea to cool just a little bit, because if you put honey into boiling tea or water, it starts breaking down the various healthful enzymes and proteins. And if you're looking for the medicinal qualities of that honey, you don't want to do that. So I personally wait until it's gotten to about a little more than tepid temperature. And then I drink my tea with honey. But what actually my favorite recipe is for soothing a sore throat is mixing one part fresh lemon juice with one part honey, stirring it up really well, swallowing it really slowly, and letting it glide down and coat your throat. So another thing, Cleopatra didn't bathe in milk and honey just because she could. Actually, honey both cleanses and restores the skin. It softens the skin. And when Amina was talking about crystallized honey, if you were to actually use a crystallized honey on your skin, it would act as an exfoliant. So this is Cleopatra, or a rendition of her, and she was alive in 69 to 30 BC. And what's really interesting is that the Egyptians, who were some of the earliest beekeepers, knew a thing or two about honey and its medicinal properties. Not only did they revere the bee, which was considered the tears of Ra, who was the sun god, so using this or treating this bee as some kind of reverential symbol and creature, but they also understood that it was a medicinal, a medicine actually. So what we're seeing right here is the Edwin Smith papyrus. It's from 1600 BC, so we're talking about 3600 years ago, and it records 48 different injuries and their remedies. And of those 48, 30 cite honey as an ingredient for healing your wounds. So in this case, it's for the remedy of if you have a flesh wound in the head. So if you fall and you crack your head against a rock and you basically expose the skull, the treatment would be to bandage your head with fresh meat on the first day and then treat it with a mixture of oil and honey every day afterwards until it heals. So, interesting, but what is actually known now, nowadays and used nowadays, is that honey is a great remedy for wounds and burns, and it's still used today. The difficulty is that in our systemized healthcare system, each honey is different. You have what's called terroir. It's like wine, where the climate, the soil, the weather, the plants that are flowering in which season, everything's different. So if you're in a hospital, if you're a doctor and you're trying to prescribe a medicine, it's difficult because you want to be controlling the dosages and the predictive potency, which is hard to do with honey. However, some innovative people have been bringing to the market some medicines that are based on honey, which you see in the picture on the right. But what happens, and the reason why it works in wounds and burns, is that when honey comes into contact with a wound, a cut, a chemical reaction occurs. And what happens is the acidity and the sodium levels rise, it activates an enzyme contained within the honey called glucose oxidase, and this produces hydrogen peroxide. And we all know hydrogen peroxide, you put that on a cut, it bubbles white, and basically what it's doing is it's killing bacteria and other microbes because it's antimicrobial. And what's great about the honey on your wound is that it slow releases this hydrogen peroxide. It's not like an instant boost and then it's done. It actually keeps going and keeps going. So it keeps your wound free from bacteria and infection. So speaking about eucalyptus honey, the jar that I have here, actually I'm gonna stop sharing for a second. The jar that I have here, it's different than all the other Ilangas because I got this when I was in Montreal. I live in Berlin and I couldn't leave without taking a jar of this. So I put it in a small container and that's why it looks different. It actually comes from central Madagascar, not far from the capital, in a low altitude in the forests, about 800 meters high. And when I smell it, I've been actually warming it up a little, so the molecules are active. And for me, when I think about eucalyptus, and Amina was talking about having many different eucalyptuses from different locations, I always associate it with menthol. And this one, to me, has a very trace scent of the menthol, but what I'm smelling instead is kind of like a musty, yeasty flavor. It's very lactose. It's super interesting. And then when I taste it, and I just want to comment about tasting. I'm using a wooden spoon. I saw Amina had a plastic spoon. I used to use metal, but what I was finding is that I was tasting the metal, and that's not good when you're trying to do a tasting. So for me, first of all, the texture, as Amina was talking about crystallization, this is very opaque. It's a fine, fine crystal. And for me, the texture, it's like butter melting in my mouth, like a solid butter. And it just adds to the experience. And what I get from this is just this warm caramel. It's like eating candy. And I love this honey so much that I use it in honey tastings. And I probably shouldn't because I should keep it to myself. But I can't resist sharing it because for me, it's just such a delicious and true experience of a unique honey. So one last thing that I wanted to talk about is that they claim that honeys absorb the medicinal qualities and properties of the plants that the honey or that the bee has been foraging on. So for instance, eucalyptus, they say, is antiseptic. It's good for respiratory and urinary infections if you have asthma, bronchitis, and as a kid, we used to do VapoRub, which is a eucalyptus menthol on your chest, and breathing the vapors would help clear out your chest and lungs. And it's an expectorant and decongestant. So that is my eucalyptus, or not mine, Ilanga's.
That is super. Thank you, Steve. And yes, for my bee team, the eucalyptus is one of the favorite ones. And it does make us think of a sort of a buttery toffee. You know, it's just so Moorish. And you do just need a pot with a big spoon. Okay, so we're going to go to Madvee now, who's got the Mokorana.
Hi there. So in my opinion, Mokorana is one of the most popular of all the Malagasy honeys that's out there. So what I have is, it's a different jar, but it's the same from the same region. And again, the flower is, the Mukarana honey is endemic. So the Mukarana flower itself is, and the plant is endemic to Madagascar, not just to Madagascar, but to a very specific region of Madagascar. So if you go to the north, you won't find it. It grows in the east, the southeastern part of the country. And yeah, so it's known locally for like different, like as a, so I'm trying, I can't, can you guys see me?
Yes, yeah, oh, right. We can see you.
All right, I just disappeared all of a sudden. So yeah, Mukarana honey is used locally to pacify children, toddlers. Even though, like, if you are from Europe, you will know that it's not recommended to give honey to children under 1 year old. Over there, it's a common practice. Another thing Mukarana is good for is they use it to soothe redness on their skin. And it's also used like a lot of other honeys to for when, if you have a sore throat, you can have some honey in tea, just like the other honey expert mentioned. So I'm gonna go ahead and try mine. First, the smell is of Mukarana honey is very different from its taste. It has not a very strong smell, but musty. It's musty and flowery, a mixture of both. What I've noticed over time is it takes more than one sniff to figure it out. When I first started, I would just have the superficial smell, aroma that comes with the honey. But the more you do it, the more you can pick up the different notes, and it's the same with the tasting. So I'm gonna taste mine.
I'm tasting with you.
I'd be happy to know how you like it. So this one, I feel like it has a very fruity smell, taste. Citrusy, but also with a mixture of caramel. It has a warm taste.
Yeah.
But it's not very lasting. So it's one of those honeys that you can consume a lot of just because you don't get sick of it.
Yeah.
It's great to cook. From my own experience, it's great for dessert and in tea, toast. It goes quite well. One thing I also wanted to talk about was when I tasted this, I noticed at the end there was a slight burning feeling. I don't know if you got that from yours.
Yes, and I think, but it's not, or this one isn't that smoky burning. When you have a honey that's been smoked, that's a very different taste. But this does, it's like a sharp, I suppose it's if you have lemon peel. If you had baked lemon peel and then it just sort of burns your throat.
Okay. I wanted to ask you about that because this one, it's lasting. And I can feel it even after I've tasted it several times. So I think it has to do with the smoking. It might be a slight over-smoke honey, which is a very common defect that you find in African honey worldwide, region-wide. So what happens is African bees are known to be more aggressive. And very often our beekeepers, and it's not just in Madagascar, it's throughout the continent, they over-smoke the hives before they go in for inspection or harvesting. So that sometimes the over smoke translate into goes into the honey, and if it's done too much, you can even smell it. Yeah. So it's a bad beekeeping technique that we are trying to improve on. So that's one of the things that we teach our beekeepers, how not to, like, one, first tell them why you, like, you know, you use the smoking the smoker, but also then show them what difference it does to the honey when you over smoke and when you don't over smoke. Because what has happened over many, many years is people got used to the smoky taste of honey. So they think that's normal. Yes. So, like, what you will have people who will associate, like, the smoky taste with African honey, and they would think that's, like, a normal thing coming from the region when it's actually a defect. Many honey, like, producers won't be able to sell, like, to certain, like, if you want to sell to Europe, it's a no-no. The buyer would come, they will, if they can pick up the smoky taste or smell, they will reject your order.
Yep. I was working, or I was visiting Cocos Keeling Island, and then I was helping work with the bees, with a small honey producer. And I was quite surprised how much smoke they used. And the bees there were really quite calm. And I don't use smoke at all with my bees. And that started because I could never get the smoker to stay alight. So I had to learn how to work with bees without a smoker. And last year for a client, our bee team, we actually extracted honey without using any smoke. And, you know, it was a very spiritual practice. And we spoke to the bees beforehand, you know, I meditated with them, and then we sort of asked how much honey we could have. And what we did as well was we took individual frames from three supers. So instead of just taking a whole box of honey, we took each super off, we took out frames. We didn't use any smoke, we didn't have queen excluders, and we hadn't used any sort of escapes to remove the bees. So this is a really labor-intensive way of getting honey. But none of us were stung. And the bees had cleared the frames that we could take. So just with a quick brush of grass, that got any odd bees off. But it was amazing. And there was no smoke. And now when we're working with the bees, we tell them, we say, right, next week we're going to visit you on this day or that day, and we're going to open the hive. And we only do a full inspection twice a year. And what we try and do is we'll just open up, and if there's been a good honey flow, we'll just take the odd honey out. But when I was on Cocos Keeling, I tasted the honey. I was given a jar of honey and I tasted it, and instantly it was like, oh, that's really, you could feel it burning your throat. So when I was working with them and they were extracting the honey, and there was just so much smoke. And again, I think it's that training, and it's a habit. It's sort of, instead of a puff, it's like a puff, 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 you know, and they're going around puffing. And it is just a habit, you know, without being stung or anything. It's like, let's just keep smoking them. But when we took apart the hive, there was a lot of extra wild comb in the roof. And so we kept that aside. And when we took the honey and put the hive back together again, I suggested swapping the roofs so we could taste the honey in this wild comb. And the color was different, the taste was different. Mm-hmm. And it was the first time that family had tasted honey without the smoke, and they could see that difference. But I think, you know, like you said, they get familiar with it, you know, it becomes that taste. But I've got a mokorana here, and when I first started tasting the Ilana Nature honeys, and I, you know, the Nauli, which you'll have to remind us how to pronounce properly, that's quite it's quite a shock if you're used to sweet honeys, and then you try that one, it's almost savory. And so when I found the mokorana, it was like, oh, wow, that was my favorite honey. You know, it's just because it is so citrusy. It is sort of boiled sweets. It's mango. Mm-hmm. It's tropical. So the trees,
the mixture of it that I like. It's very interesting. And you have different notes as you keep tasting it. Yeah. You have other honeys that have a caramel-like taste, but it's still a different caramel-like taste.
Yeah.
As compared to this one.
And I think with all of these, you need to keep, well, with all honeys, you need to keep tasting them, because each time, I think as a honey tasting expert, you have to get to that point that you see the jar and you have an expectation of what you should be finding in that jar. And then you know that you've got a grasp of what that honey is. but it takes a lot of tasting. So if we can go, thank you so much, Madvee. So if we can go to Laura now, and you've got a delicious one, haven't you, for us?
I'm in awe of this one. This is absolutely amazing. I received 4 honeys, and this one was my absolute favorite, just because, I had 2 favorites. It's a lychee honey, if you can see the jar there, and then the eucalyptus. But as honey's like wine, it's dictated by its terroir. Just like you would have a wine with a specific type of food, or during a specific season like spring and summer, you'd probably have a wine sort of for in the autumn or the winter. And I prefer, let's say in the winter, a nice red wine, an oaky cask, a reserve red wine, and something that's very warming. So in the spring and the summer, I like quite a very sort of virginal green wine. And lychee is more akin to something that I would love to have in the spring and summer, because it's very, very refreshing. And it's just, it just reminds me of summer sort of evenings. Whereas the eucalyptus is a lot more warming and a bit more akin to something for the autumn or the winter. When I first received them, the lychee is crystallized. And I noticed it's a lot more crystallized in comparison to the other honeys I received. And I thought, okay, this has a high glucose concentration. And apparently it crystallizes quite quickly. So that's quite akin to sort of like the soft fruit blossoms that we have here in Scotland. Let's say the raspberry honey in particular, which crystallizes very quickly as well, because it has a high glucose to fructose ratio. As we all know, that honey is a mixture of glucose and fructose. The higher the fructose content, which is basically the sugars are dictated by the flour, the more liable it's to stay runny. And the higher the glucose concentration, then the more likely it is to crystallize. So when I received this and I opened it up, and the aroma is just absolutely amazing. It's very clean. It's very fresh. And you can smell sort of roses. It's very warming as well. It's sort of reminds me a bit of citrus honey in a way, whereas sort of when you sort of breathe it in, you can smell the blossoms, and it's got quite a warming sensation to the nose. So I really, really like that. It reminds me of sort of when you're walking through a summer's evening, and you can smell sort of blossoms in the air on the summer's night, particularly something like nightstock, for example, and you've got that aroma sort of going through the air and it's tickling your sort of nostrils in that sort of way. So I really, really like that. And then sort of when you taste it, because it crystallizes quite quickly, there, I presume you've got these quite sharp, large sugar crystals, which take a long time to basically melt in your mouth. But the taste is it's very tropical. I can taste lychee sort of straight away, sort of guava, for example. A lot of people will associate lychee with rose. And then towards the end, there's quite an astringency going on, and it's quite dry. So it's a really nice sort of like, just sort of reminds you of sitting on the beach and breathing in sort of like sort of the dry summer air in that instance. And it just sort of is just really, really refreshing. So I could sort of imagine this in a sort of, you know, if you were to pair it with sort of fresh fruit, for example. But I think my perfect pairing with this would be in a cocktail, for example, because it's got this lovely, refreshing palette to it. We're sort of we like our drink here in Scotland, so but I could just imagine this sort of paired with a vodka or gin, and because it's very delicate in flavor, it's sweet and it's delicate, it's not strong and robust, let's say, like the eucalyptus, but it's medium sweet, so, and it's very amenable as well. So you could pair that with sort of vodka or gin, and something which doesn't overpower it as well, just to let that delicate sort of the fragrant notes and the delicate palate to sort of shine through. But I'd also probably use that the same as I would use orange blossom honey, for example. And as we know in the Middle East, they use a lot of orange blossom honey paired with rose petals, for example, and they use it for sweets like, you know, sort of with pastries and things like that. So yeah, it's very, very elegant, and a definite one to keep here, because I've never tasted anything like this over here. As we know, the lychee, for example, correct me if I'm wrong, Paula, but it's sort of one of the main sources of economy, basically, for the farming community in Madagascar. And I think it's 25,000 tons of lychees are produced per year. And I think 80% of the lychees that we actually have here in Europe are exported from Madagascar as well. So it's a huge economy, and it sort of creates a social structure and a community in Madagascar. And one would presume that to produce such a high quantity of fruit and high quality fruit production, one of the major things that they must have to rely on is pollination. And in order for that to happen, not only do they need very healthy bees, which are basically healthy for the environment, but for every hive of bees, you have to basically provide 250 kilos of nectar, which is why it's essential for the reforestry of the trees on the island, in order for that to sort of happen. So the lychee is one of the major sources of economy for the island, very similar to the raspberry here in Scotland. The farm here started in 1950s and was very highly reliant on the raspberry farms in the local area, which have been producing raspberries for over 100 years. Fruit culture is part of our heritage, and sadly, over the last 20 years, the farmers have been pulling those canes out and replacing them with other varietals, which are not endemic to Persia, where we're based. And they're replacing them with varietals from overseas, for example. They're all dictated by the supermarkets. So we're losing those single varietal fruits, which our bees have been basically gathering nectar from, and that dictates the flavor of our honey. So what we used to call raspberry honey now, we now call blossom honey, because the bees are foraging from a variety of different flowers, and that's rape, spring blossoms, there's tree blossoms, wild flower blossoms as well. And so it's a polyfloral honey in that instance. So we've lost the flavor of the raspberry in our honey. But what we're really, really worried about is that our bees have been pollinating these crops for over 60 years. And our farmers are reliant on pollination to produce the perfect fruit and the perfect flavor, because our local area is renowned for producing the best soft fruit in the world. And our bees, in turn, they gather that nectar that makes our blossom honey, but it also keeps our colonies strong when we start to move the hives in sort of July to the heather moorlands when the heather starts flowering. So for us, it's this natural synergy, and collaboration is incredibly, incredibly important to us. Our farmers, basically, the pollination with our bees is in excess of a worth of over a million pounds to our farmers. And it's a collaboration where it's a win-win for both parties. They basically depend on our bees for pollination to produce that fruit. Our bees are dependent on the nectar. And in turn, we basically also gather the second class fruit from our farmers, which would either go to waste or they would get, not very much for them at all. And we take that fruit and we handcraft it and make our own 100% natural preserves. It's 100% minimal natural ingredients. So we let the flavor of the single vegetable fruit shine through. And each sale of basically of our honeys and preserves is not sort of just there to sustain the honeybee and its essential work in pollination, but it's also there to sustain our cultural and natural heritage, because it's a small community that we have here, and it's a rural community as well. And fruit farming is part of our heritage, and that's sadly sort of disintegrating, particularly at this time when we are going through strange times, and farmers are reliant on people to work the land, and they're finding it very, very hard for that to happen at the moment. So it's incredibly, incredibly important to us to sustain that and to sustain our local economy as well in that instance.
It's amazing, isn't it, that the similarities people have around the world with agriculture. And I think now people are becoming more aware. I mean, that we've been aware about pollinators for a number of years now, but just how complex a relationship it is. And as Steve was saying, it's the connectivity of all things. You know, you remove one part of the connection and everything falls apart. So it's really, you know, I think so many people, when they're buying food, they're completely oblivious to the story that goes behind the production of that food and also the impact on the food choices you make. So when you buy something, you are either contributing or preventing certain farming practices. And if you really want to save the bees, you've got to be aware of where you're buying your food from, because if the food you're buying is dependent on a really intensive industrial farming practice, then that's going to have an impact on the environment that it's grown in. And so you're contributing to that. And sometimes people feel overwhelmed, or they think, what difference can it make with what I do? But particularly through this current situation with COVID, I think people are becoming a bit more aware of the choices they make and quality, and thinking about where their food comes from and food security. So, you know, I'm hoping that we can have a positive change from this and actually all start to conscious shopping, conscious food eating.
Exactly. Now, everyone wants to know where their food comes from, how it's sourced, but it only takes one person. Everyone thinks, well, one person's not really going to make a difference, but it only takes one, because if you make that conscious choice, someone else there will probably make that same choice that you don't realize. And then you get a whole group of people doing that as well. And it's really important to know where your food is coming from as well, most particularly with honeys, because honeys in the supermarket, we're just used to that all the time. And a lot of the honeys that we purchase, particularly in the UK, they're adulterated, you know, and the bees are force-fed sugar. And when they're force-fed sugar, you're not tasting the nectar of the flower. And you are basically destroying the health of the bees as well, because it's like living on a diet of white bread. And so that is actually being translated to you, because the health benefits of the flower is not coming to you through that source. So it's this whole chain reaction. And when you actually taste a good honey, you know, one that's been produced properly, the bees have been sort of well treated, they're feeding on nectar, the flowers, the land's maintained properly, the processes of people. It's not just the terroir that you can taste, but it's almost like an energy. You know how you have a painting that you can be sort of technically brilliant, or you're listening to a piece of music that's technically brilliant, but there's a certain soul that's in that as well that needs to be captured. And if you haven't got that, it's almost like you've lost a bit of life. And it's the same with anything. It brings like a unique quality. And when you taste a honey, like particularly a monofloral, in comparison to adulterated honey, you can actually taste the positive energy within that. That might sound like nonsense to a lot of people, but there's a certain thing that's more sort of, it goes beyond the technical ability. It's like an energy that you can taste, I think, in that instance. But I don't know, some people might call that crazy, but to me, that sort of makes sense.
Oh, no, beautiful. Thank you. So it's amazing how quickly the time goes when we're all having so much fun and talking about our favourite things, and I'm sure we could all talk for an hour. So what we'll do is I'll just taste one honey, and I'm going to use jujube. And while I'm tasting that one, those of you who are watching, if you have any questions, you can type them in the comments. And after I've tasted my honey, we can go through any of the questions. So if you've got anybody in particular you want to ask a question, then just name them. We've all got our names here. And just a reminder as well that in a month's time, on the 19th of June, we're going to announce a winner of a box set of 5 of the Ilanga-Nature honeys. And that's to the person who shared and commented and tagged the most friends for these videos for World Bee Day. Not forgetting, of course, that the reason we're doing this is to help promote the honeys of Madagascar, to support the beekeepers who need trees. So we want to sell enough honey that we can plant 1 million trees in Madagascar. They've got the room, they've got the manpower, they've got the bees that need feeding. So together we can really make that difference. So what I'm going to taste, which I found so interesting, and this backs up what everybody said about medicine and about the difference of the same flower from different parts of the world. Now, jujube, this is my sample, and it is quite, it is crystallized. And you can see but it's still, oh, hang on, it's, everything's back to front. There we go. Sorry, I hope I didn't make anybody feel dizzy then. So it's really bright yellow. So it almost looks like a dandelion or a sunflower honey with its colour. And it's quite grainy. So it's semi-granulating. Now, like some of the others, I'm using wood. Plastic is good because it doesn't affect the taste, but we just don't want to keep using plastic. So it's one of those problems. Now, jujube is a tree with spikes and red berries, and it's really, really rich in nectar. So bees only need to do about 10 trips to a jujube flower, but it's also known as cidre. And what I find really fascinating is I first came across cidre honey in the Middle East, and I've got a sample here, which is from Oman, and you can see the difference. So this is the same tree, but from different parts of the world. Now, the cidre from Oman, it's very sticky. It's sort of a glucose honey. It doesn't really crystallize. It's very pure, but it isn't really, really runny. So it's quite an unusual texture. And it has a really almondy flavor. It could not be more different to the jujube or cidre from Madagascar, which is very fruity. You have that citrus, very similar to the mocarana. So, that's interesting as well, because it makes you think about how does the soil impact the flavors of the trees. So if they're from a similar area, you know, is that going to have a difference? But I absolutely love this. So it's quite smooth. It's not as grainy as the lychee. The lychee is a bit like a sorbet, I think, just a warm sorbet. So you've got that sort of crystallization that you get with a sorbet, but it's not cold. So really, really delicious. So I think we've all just loved having a taste of these honeys. And if you want to have a taste, then you can go onto the crowdfunding page, and we've got various packages where you can actually taste, you know, you can order samples of honeys, and you know you're planting trees as well. But to follow on from what Steve had said earlier about honey being medicine, and when I first went to Oman, or before I went, I'm studying herbal medicine, and one of my tutors had asked if I'd read the Quran, and I hadn't. So as it was one of my tutors, I thought, well, I'd better read it. And there's a whole chapter called The Bee. And in there is a paragraph where it says that go put the hives in the mountains and in the trees and where they choose. And then it says from their bellies emerges a fluid of diverse colors containing healing for the people. Surely in this is a sign for those who reflect. And I just thought that just blew me away. So for many thousands of years, people have known that honey is medicine. And there is this spiritual connection between humans and bees. And we are part of the connection. And if we're going to be taking the honey from the bees, our role is to feed the bees, to make sure that they can actually provide the honey. So I feel that we've neglected our role. We've been taking the honey, but without providing the forage for the bees. So let's hope that through World Bee Day today, we can inspire people all around the world to actually plant some more trees, feed some more bees, and change the world. Because as Laura said, we can, it starts with us. We can all make a difference. So I'm just having a look through. I think people are more stunned than with questions. So I'm going to open up to the panel. Does anybody else have anything that they would really like to share before we close?
Well, I wanted to show something. I also can't figure out where. I wanted to show something that I have done that puts together what Steve was talking about with lemon. This is actually just sliced lemons that here in California we get Meyer lemons, which have a very, very mild mild flavored skin. It's got chunks of ginger root in it, and it's sage honey. And when you do it, I put it in the refrigerator, I use it over and over medicinally or just for any syrup, the honey actually becomes liquid. So can you see how it's pouring in here? It literally changes from being very viscous to being very, very liquid, and you can use it. It's infused with the flavor. It's really an amazing way to just use any honey. I do tend to use the ones that are here local in California because that's what's easiest for me to get. But it's a really great way to do exactly what Steve was talking about, put it all together.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you. Madvee, do you have anything?
Sure. I wanted to stress on the importance of the crowdfunding and the reforestation initiative. You mentioned it before, but yes, Madagascar is a biodiversity hotspot. For those who don't know, to be defined as a hotspot, you have to have at least 1,500 endemic plant species in the country. Madagascar has over 11,000 of those. And to this day, like, they are still discovering new species every year. So it's an ecosystem that has so much unknown, but I can only imagine the different honey varietals that can come out of this. But not just for the honey, but also for the people who live there. I think they will benefit so much from like this initiative and from knowing that their hard work in beekeeping pays off.
Oh, that's wonderful. And I do want to just add to that all the trees that are being planted are endemic to Madagascar. So the eucalyptus is endemic to Madagascar. It's not a case of shipping trees from other parts of the world. We'll be planting trees that are meant to be there, so saving what they've been losing. And Steve, would you like to?
Sure. So in honor of this evening and the 1 million planting of trees, I wore this shirt, which says, plant these, save the bees.
Oh.
And I think that you can support the campaign to plant trees in Madagascar, but you can also do this locally. And as people have been saying, if you're planting native trees, native shrubs, native flowers on your balconies, in your schoolyards, churchyards, working with your local park, you can be providing habitat and forage for pollinators, not just bees, but all the pollinators. So help with biodiversity locally.
No, that's absolutely right. And I've even, here's a little plug, I did a tea towel, which is plants for bees. So it gives you 12 plants that will feed the bees throughout the year. So it is all about food, isn't it? So Laura, would you like to have a word just before I give the final word to the Malagasy beekeepers themselves?
It's just such, it's just really humbling to be part of such a group and to collaborate, especially sort of in this day of technology where you can connect with people from all over the world, you know, in one small place. But I think what I would really like to share is just sort of the plethora of the honey varietals from around the world. And a lot of people have always asked me, you know, but I want to buy local, I want to buy local, I want to buy local. And to me, it's like local's amazing. Your supply chain is short, you know where your food comes from, you know how it's produced because you're speaking to your local beekeeper. But honey is a bit like cheese and wine. And if you were to restrict your palate to, let's say, three types of cheeses or three bottles of wine, you've been denying this opening sensory experience of these wonderful things from around the world. And particularly at a time where we can't really travel, we can still travel with our food and experience different cultures and experience different stories. Because as we know, when you taste something, it evokes certain memories and it brings certain emotions. And I think as human beings, we have to maintain that sensory experience because as soon as we lose that, I think we dull our senses. And we lose a vital part of life. So we need to keep doing that. And there's some amazing varietals from around the world. As Paula had said, you know, each flower produces a different type of nectar, which is there to keep the plant healthy and keep predators at bay and attract pollinators. And each one is a unique cocktail. So no one honey is exactly the same. And I think we need to go out there and basically try everything as much as possible.
Oh, that's lovely. Lovely. So thank you so much, Laura from Scotland, Amina from California, Madvee from Kenya, and Steve in Berlin. And I'm going to end with a film that if you've watched the earlier ones, you will have seen before, but it's just beautiful. And it just shows the beekeepers and the forests of Madagascar. So I will say farewell and thank you so much for joining us. And if you're watching this on replay, thank you very much. And just please, please, please go to the crowdfunder. The smallest amount is £10 and that will plant 50 trees, which really makes a difference. And those trees will be cared for by these beekeepers.
Zay ety izany a gajerena ny eo amin'ny tontolo iainana mbola anatina ala fa fanetana manila amin'ny mirankazo isaky
ny fambolena zany eto ny fambolena fambolena azo matona eto ary ny misy moa zany ary mbola manana tany malaladalaka zany dia fanampinan'ireny azo kininina zay anaovana eucalyptus ireny tena ny mampisongadina ny eto amin'ity fokontaninanjory ity zany a dia fiarovana an'izy ireny eo amin'ny resaka fiarovana an'le tontolo iainany zany a tsy maintsy mamela renikazo a isaky ny ray ara ary io renikazo io zany tena mamelona ny tantelona eto
ny kômina aloha dia efa miara-miasa mpiompy tantely amin'ny fandripahana ny ala say, Pupta Pilkuman Intananula Sanchanji Patamiala Sachi, Matali Pupkirnai.
Usually, which I call you Fandrunas, but Tanitsan in a Natri Twir and Indian Sea, the Chi. Nate Fandrunan is with Taneti, Miss with Taneti Mandrus, Avrina, the Chasa, Tueti and Naya, but the Manapaka, the Sufayan Sail, while the top of Fandrunas and Sisuichi, the Mena Yin and a Yin.